Hey guys, Vikas over here and you are watching We Are Genius. Guys, today I am again with a new video around ESP32. In this video, we will be building an energy monitoring device that will enable us to monitor energy consumption of electronic devices remotely. To send the energy readings to the cloud, I am going to use LoRaWAN. So the ESP module that I will be using over here is the TTGO ESP32 module that comes with LoRa transceiver and one OLED display in a small form factor. This will enable us to monitor energy consumption in remote places where other connectivities such as Wi-Fi is not available. And due to the long range nature of LoRa communication, such monitoring devices can be scattered across a geographical area without the need of repeaters. To monitor energy consumption parameters, I am going to use the PZM004T module, which can measure voltage from 80 to 260 volt and current up to 100 amps. To measure such high current, it is just one external current transformer. Over here, I'll be using the version 2 of this module. If you are going to use version 3 of it, the commands used are quite different, but the overall idea is quite similar. And also the version 3 of it features some more parameters compared to version 2. The data rate from the PZM module will be sent to the Things network using LoRaWAN protocol. Again, as we are using LoRaWAN, you need to have a gateway around and it should be connected to TTN. Then only it is going to work. Finally, the data will also be displayed in the OLED module that comes with the TTGO ESP32 board, so that you can check the consumption in real time. So being said that, let's get started guys. So guys, let's check out the connection diagram, and the connections to be made are pretty much straightforward. The PZM module comes with UART interface, whereas it has to be connected to one UART interface of the ESP32 module over here. So the ESP32 module that I'm using over here, the TTGO LoRa module particularly, comes with two hardware serial ports exposed, but we can't use that because one is being used for programming and stuff, and the second one, that RX pin is used for OLED reset. So here I'll not be using the hardware serial port, rather than I'll be using software serial. For that, actually you can use any digital IO pin, and over here I'm using pin number 13 and pin number 21. So this particularly over is a mistake. Actually this is pin number 21. So pin number 21 is used as TX pin, whereas pin number 13 is used as RX pin. One disclaimer over here, the PZM module comes with 5 volt TTL, whereas the ESP32 module supports 3.3 volt. So over here, when connecting the TX pin of the ESP32 module to the RX pin of PZM module, we don't need any sort of logic level shifter because the 3.3 volt output can be pretty much detected by PZM module. But when we are feeding the output of the PZM module, which is again 5 volt over here, to the ESP32 board, which supports 3.3 volt, we need some sort of logic level shifter. So over here, I am using 2N7000 FET as a logic level shifter, but you can use anything that you are having around. So the 2N7000 along with couple of resistors over here is used as logic level shifter. So if you want a simple solution without using any FET and all, you can simply use a resistor divider, and which will output 3.3 volt whenever there is input of 5 volt and all. But that doesn't work with high speed communication. So over here that will work if you, as long as you are using baud rate of 9600 and around. But if you are going for high speed, that won't work. So FET is going to be a better situation in high speed communication and all. But for low speed, a resistor divider will also work. Also, you can use any other logic level shifter that you are having. So if you want to know more about 2N7000 at logic level shifter, you can check out my earlier video on this, for which there is a link down below in the description. So that's all with connection pretty much. And one more thing, the 5 volt gets connected to the 5 volt of PZM module, ground connected to ground, and I'm using the 3.3 volt output from the TTGO module over here to the my FET circuit, which is acting as a logic level shifter. So that's pretty much all about it, hardware connections and all, because the OLED module and the LoRa module is there itself in the board. So we don't need any external connections for that apart from the PGDM module. So that's all with connection analog. So I'll just quickly connect my circuit accordingly to this schematic diagram, and then after we'll jump to the code part. So guys, let's check out the code. And over here I'm going to use Arduino IDE. So let's open it up, this code.ino file, and as well as there is another file config.h which holds all the configuration for this project. So you can download this codes from this particular GitHub repository, which is the link to the repository is down below in the description. So you can pretty much go through it. It has all the schematics and pin diagrams and everything you need for this project. So I'll just minimize it, and this is the code particularly. And over here I'm going to use three libraries, namely for the OLED U8x8, for the LoRa module that is LMIC, and for software serial that is ESP8266 or ESP software serial, I suppose. So I'll just go ahead and install the libraries pretty quick. Okay, after the libraries are in place, we can go through the code. But before that, just make sure you have added the BSP for ESP32. And your particular board, that is over here, TTZO LoRa 32 OLED module, is available in the board list. So over here, for me, it is there. And I have also selected the port that it is connected to. So make sure you have the drivers in place. And you have also added the support for ESP32 to your Arduino IDE. Now let's just go through the code once. So I'll just let you through the important parts over here. So over here, we have defined the pins that is being used by the onboard LoRa module, and that is connected to the ESP32 and all. After that, I have this array of hexadecimal bytes that corresponds to different commands for the PZM module. So this can be fetched from this particular data sheet of the PZM module. And yeah, you can see over here for voltage, this is a command and it starts with head and it's some checksum at the end. So this particular hexadecimal bytes array holds true if the address of the module is 192.168.1.1. So if your module's address is something else, then this won't work and you need to change it. So over here for me it is 192.168.1.1, so this pretty much will work. And if you want to change your address, you can pretty much do that by simply using this command over here. So you can send this command to your device to change the IP address or the address of the device to 192.168.1.1. And this actually I have just copied from the data sheet, nothing else over here. Then there's the unevent function for LoRaWAN. So it has different functions like EV join, event joining, joined and all. And over here we'll be using OTA method. So this joined and joining method is pretty important. After that, join parallel and all those events. So these events are invoked whenever particular event occurs. So this particular function over here, on event gets called and it takes the event also as an input. So based on that, we are just using switch case and all, and nothing else there. I'll just get to that later on. After that, do send, this is a job that we are doing, after a particular interval or something. So it lets you send the data to TTN. So over here we are doing like, you know, setup, then we are just initializing the serial port. After that we are initializing, you know, the software serial port over here, and it takes the baud rate, the parity and all, then the RX pin, text pin and the buffers. After that we are just initializing the OLED display, then we are just making message on the display that starting and all. After that we are just defining, checking if the region for LoRaWAN is correctly defined or not. So for me over here, like, if you want to change the region, so you can get into documents or wherever your Arduino libraries are there, and get into the LMIC library page, sorry, folder. After that get into project config, and you just need to make sure your region is properly configured over here. So for me it is it's going to be India 866, so I'll just comment this out, US 915, and my region is now configured over here. Also, if you just make sure your radio is particularly properly configured, so I'll just close it. So based on your region you need to config this LMIC project config.h file. So yep, that's it. After that we are initializing the LMIC and all, LMIC reset, then I'm invoking a function update meter data, so which will eventually communicate with the meter and update the energy related variables that we have defined earlier. After that I'm just checking in a loop, and I'm just checking the display update interval, and this actually is used to update the display or the OLED module over here. And I have another thing, LoRa data publish interval, so which will be used to, you know, configure the publishing interval for LoRaWAN and all. So after each within this intervals I just call update meter data, and if it is, you know, on display, then I'll just update the data over the display. Or if it is, you know, for LoRa publishing, I'll just invoke do send. So this is the initialize OLED function, nothing much over here. We are just printing out some strings and all over the display. And then I have defined a clear OLED line. So if you want to clear a particular line in the display, this can be used. So I'm just doing nothing but, you know, printing white spaces. Then set LoRa message, that will help you set a particular string over the OLED module. After that, this is quite, you know, where the meter communication happens. So over here we are just fetching voltage or whatever parameter it is, like voltage, current or energy, anything. Then we are just converting the received bytes into proper meaningful data. So over here what I've done is I have declared another array, LoRa data packet, and I'm just assigning the received data bytes into this LoRa packet array. So this will make sure I have always consistent size and the bytes are in order whenever I'm sending data to TTN, so there it can be processed easily. Later on we have this phase data function, which actually send out the command that we are sending from here, or particularly this array that we are sending, like voltage, current or whatever it is, which is defined earlier, this one. So what it does is it takes this array based on the command we are passing and writes into the serial port, and after that it waits for a certain time, like 10 seconds for me. So it will just either wait for 10 seconds or it will wait for 7 bytes of data. So it will write the command and it will wait till it gets 7 bytes, or there is a timeout of 10 seconds, and it will just read those data into this PZM response buffer. So nothing else there. After that we are using this PZM buffer for calculating the voltage and all the parameters depending upon the command that we have used. Then I have a simple debug function over here, so that print the PZM buffer data into the serial console. So that's all in this code over here. So let's look at the config.h file. Here we are having TTN keys and the timing intervals that we want to do, like, you know, update the display or we want to send the data. After that we are having the pin definitions for software serial. So for me it is 13 and 21. You can pretty much use any other pin that you want. Just make sure it is not being used internally with any other, like, you know, OLED module or the LoRa module. So I'll do one thing. I'll register my application and copy the keys to this config.h file. So for that, I'll just get into the Things Network website and the console. So I'll get into applications. So I'll create an. If you want to change the display update interval or LoRa data publish interval, you can change pretty much over here. For me, I'll just go with this. And there's one more thing over here. We are actually sending out the data in, you know, just as an array of bytes and all. So we need to decode that in TTN. To do that, I'll just get into my application and I'll get into payload formats, and there's a decoder over here. So I'll just go ahead and copy this. Actually, I have already written. So you can find this in my repository. So this will convert the payloads received into meaningful data like voltage, current, power, and energy. So over here you can see I am deriving current from power and voltage because I want to minimize the data that I am sending using LoRaWAN and all. Because current is always power or voltage, so I am not sending that data to GTM. So yeah, that's it. I'll just save payload functions. Let's get new data. So that's all about the code, guys. I'll just upload the code, but the module that I have connected to my PC is not connected to any PZM module. So I'll have data, but all should be zero. So let's just upload and confirm that code works. Now, as soon as your ESP32 module boots up, you can see voltage, current, all those levels in your OLED module, and it also show using your particular, like for me it is IN866 band. So depending upon your country or whatever message you have written over here, it should display. So let's just wait for some time because for me the PZM module is not connected. So what will happen is it will just wait till it times out. So for 4 parameters it is going to take around 40 seconds. So let's just wait for it. So it shows data sent, and you can see over here it has sent the data and all the payloads are zero over here. So that's it, guys. Data is coming over here. And let's just put the so that's it, guys. Data is coming over here. Let's connect the PZM module to the ESP32 board over here, and I'll also put an enclosure to it so just to make everything secured and all. And later I'll just connect to the main supply and we'll see if we are getting data over here. One more thing, over here I have used OTA method because if you are using ABP and all, there is something called as frame counter in TTN and all, so just to make sure you don't have MIM attacks and all. So if you are using ABP and your controller restarts, and so you need to come back to backend and you need to restart the frame counters because it will start sending again frame counter as zero, and it will be discarded by TTN as long as it is not up to the current frame counter value. So I'll just go over here. So for my device, let's say frame counter is 1 over here. So as long as the new payload coming doesn't have frame counter value more than 1 or something, it will discard. So but if you are using OTA method, that is being taken care by the TTN itself, because when it asks for keys and all during handshaking, that frame counters gets reset. So guys, I'm going to use this general purpose enclosure over here that I got from Banggood, and I'll be putting everything inside it. So I'll first go ahead with, you know, adding the PZM module to the, you know, enclosure. So I'll just drill down some holes for it. And along with that, I'll just use this general purpose connector to connect the mains cable to the PZM module. So I don't need to, you know, always open the box and connect the desired cables and all. So I'll just quickly finish it up. I'll just add it to the bottom side of it. So now the PZM module in its place and the mains cable to be connected are exposed as a general purpose connector over here. So this all with this, then just I'm adding a DC barrel jack so that it can be powered from 12 volt. And to power the TTGO module, because it takes 5 volt as input, I'm using a buck converter inside the box or the enclosure. So I'll just, and also I have there actually the enclosure comes with couple of holes to expose cables and all. So one of that I'm using for exposing the LoRa antenna, and the second one I'm using to expose the barrel jack so that it can be powered up. So finally everything in place, I've connected placed the buck converter to sidewall of the enclosure, and I'm going to place this 27,000 FET or the logic level shifter with some hot glue. Yeah, so over here I've added some hot glue for the TTGO module. So if you don't want to do that also, it is fine. But I wanted to, you know, make it closer to the transparent lid over here. So yeah, I just glued it in place. And the antenna is exposed from one the enclosure, as I said earlier, as well as the barrel jig to power it up. So yeah, that's all with this. This is a simple enclosure that I'm using, a general purpose enclosure, to put everything in place. So let's just connect it to the mains supply and I'll see if we are getting data in a TTN console. So guys, I'm done with the enclosure and I have kept everything inside the enclosure and all. And along with that, I've also connected one 15 watt bulb so that we can, you know, read out the parameters like voltage, current, power and kilowatt hour, everything. So I'm now in TTN console page, and over here I'm in the device and data tab. So now let's power on the module and see if we are getting data in TTN console. So first we'll get the activation request, as we are using OTA method for activation, and thereafter we'll have the uplink data. Yeah, this is the activation request with that IPUI, DevUI and all. And over here we also got the uplink with the NG data, and our payload converter has converted the data into respective variables like current, energy, power and voltage. Actually the payload comes as, you know, hexadecimal bytes that actually we are sending from the Arduino, and the payload converter that we wrote in TTN is converting that hexadecimal bytes into, you know, readable data. So you can see voltage is 231, power is around 16 watt, energy is 21 kilowatt hour, and current is 0.069 amps. So along with that, we also can, you know, get the same data in the OLED mode display of the module itself, and you can read it from there in real time, which actually gets updated every 1 minute. Again, if you want to update the intervals, like, you know, how often you want to send the data to TTN console or how often you want to refresh data in OLED display, you can pretty much change that in config.h file. So guys, that's all with this. I hope you have liked it. If so, hit the thumbs up button. And if you have not subscribed to our channel yet, consider subscribing it for videos like this. So see you next time with our next video. Till then, goodbye.